Saint Anselm of Canterbury. He is a medieval theologian and philosopher. He wrote largely on, you know, who God is and so on, but his approach was philosophical, and he talked about many, many more topics than about whether God exists or how God exists. He was deeply influenced by an earlier theologian and philosopher, Saint Augustine of Hippo. Hippo's a city in Africa, whereas Canterbury, that's in modern-day Britain. Saint Augustine was known for thinking of God as somebody who knows all things, who is necessary, who is very different from the way the rest of the world is, and emphasized things like how we are entirely dependent on God and we need grace because we otherwise would not believe and obey God. Now, Saint Anselm, being influenced by Saint Augustine, has picked up many of those different themes, and he tries to develop some of them. We'll look at only a few parts that are influenced by it. Saint Anselm is one of the better representatives of a larger tradition called Scholasticism, and Scholasticism is known, especially in the medieval era, as a systematic philosophical method with a lot of different views and perspectives attached to it, but strictly speaking, it's just about the systematic philosophical method. And the method is largely based off of coming up with a question, making sure the question is extremely precise, clarify what the question is, then give your answer in one sentence, and then go over some major objections and rebuttals. So you're going to be giving people a chance to give what they think, and you're trying to represent your opponent's view as well as you can, and then try to answer it so that, all things considered, everybody should be convinced, ideally. So within this larger tradition of Scholasticism, there was a commentary tradition, which is very similar to our current peer review citation system. You would go read an older text, you'd be familiarizing yourself with that major text, and then you would write commentaries on it, and people would do that as a way of practicing to show that they could be actually scholarly. So, in Scholasticism, they had major texts, including, eventually, things like Plato and Aristotle, and they commented on them and were trying to work through all of the details, showing why and how the philosopher is right or wrong. Very similar to our citation system that we have now. But they would go through whole commentaries, whole works of arguments, and not just mini articles. Now, one of the hallmarks of Scholasticism is the awareness that we need to make a distinction between general and special revelation. And this is specifically brought out in terms of natural theology. Suppose you wanted to have a study of God, but you wanted to ignore, for the sake of, method, any special revelation. The question would be, how much can you know about God from simply the information that everybody would have access to? What can you know about God without having to make reference yet to special revelation? Now, it's not going to say, hey, let's develop this this study and find out how it contradicts. That might be a worthwhile study, but their point is just to say, hey, what can be known about God that anybody in the universe can know about God? What can be known about God where you don't have to have prophecies and miracles or resurrections or anything like that? If you can come up with a systematic way of coming to questions and answers about whether God exists and what this thing would be like, then that is called natural theology. You're doing theology from the natural order, natural things, in order to talk about God, who is supernatural. So Saint Anselm's major work that a lot of people want to bring in for philosophical reasons is the Proslogion, which is largely just a discourse about the existence of God. Does God exist? How can we know that God exists? And given that God exists, what can we say about this God? What kind of being is God? What are his attributes or qualities or characteristics? Now, in order to start this discourse, he immediately recognizes an obstacle. And so he starts by opening up with a prayer. Now, I highlight this only for this one reason, that for anybody who's doing philosophy, it's sometimes really helpful to realize that you could find philosophy in just about any kind of context, any kind of way people try to communicate. So you could find some philosophy in a movie. You could find it in a published article. You could find it in someone's meditations. You can find it in a prayer. And so here we're going to be looking at St. Anselm's prayer, where he talks about God and how he understands God, and he leads into an argument for God's existence, beginning with that prayer. It's a very fascinating type of thing that you could just find philosophy in this way. Now, he starts this prayer looking at his own inability to understand God and his own weakness in being able to love and follow after God. So he sees himself, in some sense, like a fool, somebody who doesn't have wisdom, who lacks understanding, but who needs to draw closer to God in order for them to have anything that's like good in his life. So he describes himself as a fool, because a fool doesn't understand. A fool doesn't have God. That's an important move that he's making for the sake of his argument. Now, in describing himself as a fool, he realizes that he doesn't have understanding, but he believes that he needs to have faith first. He believes he needs to have faith first, because he takes it as an obstacle that if he requires understanding first, then he will never have faith. And so he's known for saying that you need to believe before you understand, and if you do believe, you could and will come to have some understanding. So you can't believe God, I'm sorry, you can't understand who God is before you believe that God is. And this is where we get this phrase in Latin, credo ut intelligam, which is like, I believe in order to understand. He believes that he needs to have faith first before he could have any understanding. If he didn't have belief first, that is, if he were still going to be an atheist, then he would never understand who God is. This will be relevant to how his argument is structured and how it goes.